Hello, everyone. Would you like to be my Valentine?
No.
Words can't bring me.
Someday.
We are all in chairs of equal height. Evan is just really fucking tall.
He's really? He's a giant.
Oh, thanks. Hey, have you ever wanted to see Romeo and Juliet 2D animated? By cartoon seals?
I've always
or sea lions
I've
by one
this.
Person
or sea lions.
Ever since
not
I was
sure
2 years old,
with jazz music.
Ever since I was 2 years old, my first
if
spoken
not,
sentence was, "I want to watch Romeo and Juliet, but with cartoon seals," and my wish has been fulfilled. Like, this is my entire life leading up to this one moment. I watched this movie.
If not,
did not disappoint at all.
Lifelong goal.
If not, too bad! We're watching Romeo and Juliet sealed with a kiss. Now, before we actually get into the review, I want to take a quick minute to say that, like, you all know Bobsheaux, right? It's spelled Bobsheaux, but his name's Bob Thomas. It's, for some reason, said Bobsheaux. He's this reviewer who I discovered. He was actually the one who got me into, like, movie reviewing. The first review I ever saw of him was Romeo and Juliet Sealed with a Kiss, and I was so fascinated by it that I had to watch more of him, and it eventually got me into Nostalgia Critic, and eventually I decided, hey, let's do that, but better, or worse. Well, worse at first, but now it's better.
But different.
Yeah. And the point now is that, like, Bobsheaux was the one who actually got me into reviewing. He is both constructive and critical in all the right ways, and hilarious as fuck. So, I have him to thanks, and to show it, we are watching the first movie I ever saw him review.
It's a cinematic masterpiece.
Yeah.
Yeah, a masterpiece.
So, how does the movie begin?
So there's these seals. There's, like, there's brown seals.
And white seals.
And, this is quite possibly a metaphor for racism, but the way they do it is that they're families. I know this is Romeo and Juliet, and there's the Montagues and the Capulets. And they are
mate.
Families, but, like, the way they do it in here is that they're the only families.
Yeah, we don't
thing.
See any other seals.
They don't exist. They
and
were
they
only
each other.
Only
and
the prince who's
other,
an elephant seal.
Which creates some highly unfortunate implications by the fact that the only way they reproduce is by incest. Because the only because
that's the only logical
only one other
conclusion.
Family
seal art online.
But also, there's like there are exactly two women in this entire movie. It's weird calling them women because they're seals.
No,
but
there's more. Because remember the party?
Yeah, the fish.
There's no and, oh no the other party.
All right,
the Capulet
so,
party.
Yeah, after we get established, this they give. This movie that is supposed to be based on a tragedy, we get some happy jazz music and are immediately treated to Benvolio, who is a goofy character, you know, because he's fat and likes to eat.
I'm so fat. I'm a big, big fatty.
And he's being chased by a bunch of, crackers. I mean,
Capulets?
Yeah, crackerlets. Capulets. Okay, whatever. There's a big war that breaks out. Also, Mercutio comes in and he
well,
starts
it's really
making
more of a chase.
Yeah, like
than a fight.
Yeah.
Even.
Speaking of chase, they look like Scooby-Doo. Mercutio looks like Scooby. Both Benvolio and Romeo, as we'll see later, look like Scrappy, kind of. And yeah, that's all I can think of.
To be or not to be. That is the question.
Oh man, I didn't study for this test. He's one of those characters that once he speaks, you gotta fucking put a face mask on him. And even then, he'll still not shut up unless he's killed.
Gag his mouth.
So they get into a war and they start using other animals as tools because they're oppressive little shitheads. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly, the sky turns all red and the water turns to blood as we are introduced to the greatest threat known to seal kind. Drumroll, please.
The prince.
Yeah, and we all know this. Bobsheaux made fun of him looking like a scrotum. He is an elephant seal, we all know that. Mm-hmm. He,
You disturb this beach again. Your very lives will pay the price. If you piss me off in the middle of my jacking off time once more, I will send you to live with the filthy, fucking ugly sharks.
I think
the
my biggest
greatest threat to seals is so as humans clubbing them, but...
Or I'll just breathe on you and you'll die.
All of you!
So then Mercutio decides to go and tell Benvolio about his grand scheme to get laid with Capulets.
Oh, there's a party.
He probably got sick of living in Alabama and decided to hit up with women who aren't actually related to him. Unfortunately, yeah. Romeo is acting like sophomore Evan and moping about how no girl likes him.
I'm a nobody. Nobody will love me. I'm so lonely, and I need a somebody.
Anyway, this Romeo dude, basically your average r/nice guy, person, basically he's like, oh, I'll never find love.
And he gives me he really reminds me of my earlier insecure years when I was reviewing stuff that I am thankful that I moved on from.
And then falls deeply in love with the first girl he meets.
Whoa, you're going a little fast, but yeah, that is basically the gif.
The male to female ratio of seals are highly whack. So many of these seals desperately, absolutely... They're down bad, down horrendous. They need some cooch bad. But, unfortunately, not all of them can get it.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just...
So then he sings a shitty song that just sounds like they made it up as they went. They probably just looked at the first script for him and were like, sure, throw it in. It'll spew up time.
I don't want some party girl. I want to find an oyster's pearl. I need a girl who will... understand.
I believe in miracles. Where you from? You sexy thing.
Okay, that didn't happen.
Romeo apparently didn't hear Mercutio spout that it was a Capulet party, and he has some reservations about that. But Benvolio's only there because he's fat and he likes eating. The fat character likes eating. What an idiot, am I right?
Joke is funny.
I think
the joke is funny.
In the live stream reactions, Aiden was just losing it, and we'll show those on screen now.
Hang on, I didn't hear this joke. It has to. I'm sure. That
yeah,
it was,
I didn't hear the punchline.
The most brilliant joke of all time.
Why did the fish swim into the sandbank to get some sand dollars?
Fucking hilarious!
Sand. Bank, sand, dollars.
You're never gonna guess how in the original they were all wearing masks and costumes, so that's why they were able to go in undetected.
Gentlemen, relax.
Watch and learn from the master.
In this movie, they put on white face.
They literally cover themselves in snow. Could you imagine doing that? Like, trying to blend in. By covering yourself with snow.
So Romeo is originally hesitant, but then he sees himself in a mirror. Or he sees his reflection. Oh, wait, that's Juliet. Yeah. Okay, I've often said, like, female characters. That might sound a little misogynistic, a little, because it's like, females. But, like, you know she's a girl because she's being forced into marriage by the prince, who I call the princophile. Seriously, anyone who's that big and hitting on a character who clearly was just born yesterday has some dubious implications.
Yeah, by the way, Romeo and Juliet are both minuscule with gigantic fucking heads.
They look like, and yeah, Romeo and Juliet were children in the original, but...
Juliet is really just an alternate Smash skin.
So true.
And the prince has this little proposal to offer.
You know, Juliet, I'm not married yet.
And I'm just sitting here laughing.
Oh my god. So
because
cringy.
This guy is very clearly never left the cave. And
he leaves it all the time and goes up to every woman he sees and says, I'm not married yet.
I would pay money to see someone do that. I would pay money to see anyone propose to someone they like without even interacting with them. I would actually pay money to see that.
Definitely an incel.
Yeah.
Royalty, yet he is definitely an incel.
Yeah, like you know, Elliot Rodger saw himself as half white, so therefore he deserves women.
What's your sign?
wait. So then he comes back and Romeo starts hitting on her immediately. He said that he, in the song before, he said that he wanted to meet someone who is intimate with him and not just some party girl. Immediately tries to make out with the first girl that will actually tolerate his existence.
Hi. I don't want some party girl.
Can I call you dad?
Man, what a funny thing. I love it when a third try to marry a little girl. Just hilarious.
That dance was meant for me.
And then the prince comes in and tries to eat him. And at that point, you're just leaving. You think it's
he's
over.
Like, that's my girl. I will not go back to the incel forums tonight.
So then he gets... But then Mercutio and Benvolio free him, and it turns out that...
Considering that he's trying to force her into a marriage, he actually shares a lot of beliefs with the incels on Reddit.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, like, I've seen incel posts. They're fucking disgusting. So, that's a topic for another day, but, like... So, yeah, instead of getting punished over not staying in his lane, then, Juliet's father, who's probably related to old Hermit, then forces his daughter to marry the prince. By the way, the prince has mouth diarrhea.
Yeah.
I think I meant to say that.
Yeah, it's his breath is disgusting.
Alright, so what happens after that?
Fuck.
The hill?
Fuck if
the
I
hill.
Know.
Oh, yeah, like... Juliet's like on the hill or whatever.
You know the hill from the Nightmare Before Christmas.
You know the Romeo, where art thou, my Romeo or whatever.
Also, yeah, wherefore art thou isn't what they said actually, but yeah. Okay, yeah, that's
Romeo
nitpicking.
Comes up and they're just like they're there, they're doing things. I don't.
It doesn't even matter, but like
I'm saying, it's that their version of that.
But
scene.
Like
I think we were just kind of memeing at this point. Not
yeah, like we just kind
plot.
Of yeah.
We zoned out during the middle.
I kind of wanted to grab a drink.
Son of my only enemy.
Oh man, I love it when white girls talk about how I would be better off as one of their own kind. It gets me every time. I love it so much.
Yeah, they sing about how much they love each other after one conversation that ended badly.
And after he was stalking her.
I love you.
Party girl. Juliet, will you marry me?
What sound does an apple make?
Juliet!
I'm coming, Daddy!
No!
I hate my life and I wanna die.
Well, I mean, at least he actually kind of...
Yeah, at least he asked instead of saying, you will marry me.
The prince was like, you're a woman, you don't have a choice in the matter.
That's, yeah, these are the times that certain people want to go back to, ladies and gentlemen. It's probably just because they could do this. That's probably why, and it's disgusting. So, yeah, but we cut to Mercutio, and he's making the stupidest jokes ever. He's just making dad jokes. He probably has a joke about, like, what to say when you meet someone for the first time.
Yeah, he was telling a bunch of jokes. Eventually, it became, like, it started out as so bad it's good kind of funny, and then they started to become, like, actually funny, because he just started talking about how great it would be if Capulets were dead. Literally just consulting
Capulet genocide is justified.
What do you call a Capulet with one brain cell? Gifted!
But then, one of the jokes was, what do you call a bunch of dead Capulets? A good start.
What do you call 500 dead Capulets at the bottom of the ocean? A good start!
Okay. It's fucking dark, but it's like actually really funny. And way funnier than this fucking movie
humor.
Has any right. Like, this movie does not deserve that scene.
But then he just starts fat shaming when the prince comes in and tries to eat him.
Yep.
And it leads him to his death.
Yo, blubber butt! I wonder how deep the ocean is when you're not in it! Ah!
Romeo then goes to see Friar Lawrence, who, yes, he looks like Squirrel Merlin.
I thought he looked like the Lorax, like in the original 2D animated one.
The Lorax if he lost weight.
Yeah.
This movie is very anti-fat.
Good
people.
For him.
If you're fat and you're watching this or overweight, I am so sorry. I really am.
Juliet!
You two can't wait until after the wedding?
Come on, that was perfect. You got to admit.
I forgot to mention. There's this kiss that's in an interspecies in a relationship, played by the director's daughter. Her voice performance is pretty adorable. I'll be real.
At first I didn't like it, but then I figured out. I learned that it was his daughter, I was like, "Oh, that's cute." Then,
like, it is actually pretty cute. Like, it's a little sweet thing that the writer decided to put in because she was his daughter and stuff. Mm-hmm. But like, what really matters is that Romeo kissed her in the beginning, and then he also kissed a whale afterwards. So the Romeo harem begins. Things are about to get orgy. That sounds really stupid.
No.
Seal art on ice.
Can I kiss some kids?
No!
Are you guys married?
No!
Are you having any baby?
No!
Can I be your baby?
No!
Okay, so they get married, but like, they get married, but not before
also,
basically
also that hermit
shooting
survives
the shit
lava.
Out of each other with like...
Oh yeah.
Yeah, they're making Lawrence. Out is really weird.
And it's also really unawkward because, like, we're probably gonna get taken down because of that. Because,
Friar
like,
Lawrence in this movie is the most powerful character of all time. Not only does he just go in lava completely unscathed, he also later. This is a spoiler for the later. I know you're all gonna be devastated by the spoiler, but he gets bitten by a shark and like barely even gets hurt. Like he just loses some fur and that's it.
Yeah.
I know you're all devastated by a spoiler in this movie, but
yeah. Also, he also gets almost fully eaten by the shark and is perfectly fine.
He could defeat Thanos.
You know, what happens afterwards is that, like, they were shooting the shit out of each other with kisses, and then they do, and then the marriage doesn't have any exchange of vows or an audience because nobody wants to see it. It was about as crowded as Alexander Hamilton's actual wedding in real life.
Secret wedding.
There was literally one person who came to Hamilton and Eliza's wedding. John Lawrence. Fun fact. They won't teach you that in the musical because it was too sad. But, like, anyway, they finish off the exchange of vows, the non-existent exchange of vows and no rings, with the most epic thing we've seen up to this point.
A kiss.
I was about to be epic, okay. So yeah, they kiss one final time and the movie ends. Just kidding, I wish. And this really feels like something Sean would get a kick out of. Like, why do you think I wanted to review this for so long? So then afterwards, they decide to dance on the graves of thousands of people who died on the Titanic. That's right.
Party time, it's party time. Everybody's feeling fine because it's party time.
And then the fish that were throwing the party there are like, a Montague and a Capulet? Disgusting! Ew!
He should stay in his lane!
A Montague and a Capulet together!
It's disgusting.
Scandalous! I can't stand it!
It's an outrage!
I think I'm gonna be sexually mortified.
It definitely has some vibes.
It definitely does give you some vibes.
Interracial marriage, but
and
like,
I think it's really awkward because like the movie never took itself as seriously before, and then suddenly we're like, interracial marriage is bad. Ah! So they start chasing them, and also there's a scene with hentai, and I'm like,
there's not a scene with hentai.
It looks like hentai.
Just because an octopus grabs someone doesn't mean it's hentai.
Wait, open up.
We were supposed to act like that. FBI's coming. Alright, so, okay. After that little necessary scene, they escape the animals. They escape the raging...
My FBI agent. They escape the raging... Oh, hey, no, we're good.
Okay, we escape the raging...
You already know I look at that kind of stuff.
Alabama fish. that don't want them to be together, and then suddenly they start, like, basically fucking under a waterfall when a fish
comes in. No, they're just making out.
Yeah, when the same fish from before comes in and is like, let's start a harem with our own kids!
No, that's not what she said. She just asked if they were gonna have babies. I know, I'm just, like,
exaggerating the shit out of it.
She asked if they were gonna have babies, and she was like, I don't like babies, they're stinky.
I also don't like the ocean because it's too wet.
That was later.
So then it turns out the prince was whacking off to this, and they decide to swim away, and,
he stopped the waterfall.
He probably burped on the ocean, and that's why it looked green in that one scene.
Maybe.
Or maybe that's... Okay, I don't want to think about that. So he goes back to threaten Mercutio. He's probably going to sit on him or something, because he's fat. He has to be evil or a comic relief character.
And then that's where the fat-shaming part of the jokes comes in.
Where's Romeo?
Romeo, where are you?
And then Romeo comes in to try to save Mercutio.
But then, by the way, this is something we need to mention. The prince is a very stupid villain, self-contradictory. In some scenes, he'll act like he's fucking Thanos, but then in other scenes, he'll act like he's a second comic relief character. Yeah. Most movies have the comic relief villain and the intimidating villain as two separate characters, but this movie decided to combine, play it both ways, and it just does not work. You know who's a good example
for
of
this
a
super powerful evil villain, and he sure does get outsmarted by tiny seals that are about 1/16 of his size a lot.
Yeah, he's this unstoppable continental threat, but at the same time, he has like two brain cells.
Yes.
And sounds like Tristan
me.
From Yu-Gi-Oh! Abridged.
But anyways,
I was going to say Hades from Hercules, which we'll review in the future.
So, the fat shaming continues as Mercutio gets chased up the mountain.
Also, Romeo's dad has, like, the most unemotional reaction ever.
Romeo, my son.
I care so much. Oh, my God. Look at how concerned I am. Oh, my God.
You will find me a grave seal.
Mercutio falls. Really sad. So sad.
Especially considering he did it to himself.
Devastated.
Yeah, like, all of the seals really cared about him.
I cried more at that than I cried at Bambi's mom dying. I'm gonna
And then
be
when
honest.
Like and then when he died, I was like just kidding, they don't. The movie keeps teasing us with the fake-out death. It's not just this, but another time either. Anyway, so...
And then more rapid-fire pecking from the couple.
Until the principal decides that...
Romeo, I banish you!
I could just eat you, but sending you to let you know that your sperm will never go on is much more satisfying. So he banishes Romeo to Shark Island, which is something you'd think he would have done at the party, but he was too caught up with his, is his whole body his boner? And then he sings a song.
Juliet and I are getting married tonight.
Yeah.
Ooh, baby, baby, that's all right. What a sight.
If you were intimidated in the slightest by the prince before, this song changed every... What the fuck are you doing, bobblehead? I'm joking. I'm sorry. Okay, so anyway, he sings this really stupid song, which really puts money is such a beautiful word to shame for how bad it is. Would you agree, Aiden?
I mean, yeah. It's
money is such a beautiful word. we're going to do top 10 worst villain songs after this someday. Quest for Camelot's a movie we got to review, and it has an awful villain song. No, right, what's
moving on?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So...
got hops.
I don't like the ocean. It's too wet.
You need water to survive, you dumb.
Did you just hear that?
I don't like the ocean. It's too wet.
You're
that's
too
You can't survive out of water, I'm just saying.
So yeah, Romeo's sad because he's on Virgin Island, and then the goldfish comes back and says...
Sings Twinkle Twinkle Little Star.
But not before letting out the best line ever spoken.
Oh,
ever.
Yes. I don't like the ocean because it's too wet.
You want to go live in the desert where you'll just die immediately then? Juliet goes to whine about her very sad condition to the only person who will hear her out, Friar Lawrence, who then says, your freedom doesn't matter. Go marry the prince and be a slave. Except then he immediately changes his course when he gives us a true villain song.
The lava pool shines. And then he's like, ooh, that's something.
And then he waterboards her to death. I'm just kidding. He makes the lava drink that he... Oh, and he... And he... His entire song is basically, drink, 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 drink. Drink your problem... Drink your problems away!
What is this, a frat party?
Drink! Drink! Drink!
Yeah, you know, drinking is the reason why most men kill themselves, right? Because they try to suppress their emotion through alcohol because society won't let them express it.
Moving on.
So she doesn't die, and Mercutio is actually fucking alive.
Damn it. Yep.
He apparently has no issue whatsoever with this. And then the Capulets are sick of putting up with this. And want to know where she is. And Friar Lawrence comes in and
he's like, she's dead.
He kind of is selling himself out. The fact that they immediately believe it makes them think. I can't help but think that they probably think he killed her himself.
No, women. It's always something.
Another night with the area between the couch cushions for old Princey Pooh. I'm so lonely.
He goes to Romeo, right?
No, he just goes into the ocean to whine and probably masturbate. So then, I have no problem if you masturbate.
The fat one goes to see Romeo and tell her.
Who's apparently faster than an otter. So then the otter from before starts, like, making fun of the shark.
Yeah.
If you had any doubts about the otter being powerful before, his tail stays on after being bitten by a fucking shark.
Oh, how funny. It's the oldest gag in the book. You bite my tail, I scream.
So it doesn't hurt you, I guess? What the fuck? I guess he's just...
He probably just bit the...
Built different!
Yeah.
Could defeat Thanos. If he wanted to.
I don't even know what to say. Which follows
the shark ate
a scene where
the entire shark island... And then ate the otter. And the otter still survived.
I have really big eyebrows. Anyway. So yeah, then he teams up with the goldfish as they talk about how stupid this entire situation is. And the goldfish rips off the scene from Shark Tale. I don't know if this movie was before it. I'll have to check it. But yeah, it's literally the scene in Shark Tale.
She's like, spank him.
Spank him.
Say hello to my little friends. Say hello to my little friends!
Shark eats them. Toasty! And then Romeo is like, oh, tell me about Juliet, and we...
Watch this. This is like the greatest... This is the greatest mood swing with colors. Pregnant.
Dead.
It just turns to grayscale. I love the... Like, visually, I actually do love this movie.
Okay, here's something we have to talk about. The mood setting in this movie is unironically amazing. When a character starts feeling happy, it'll be all, like...
Vibrant.
It'll be all vibrant and colorful with the stars aligning and shit.
Mm-hmm.
And then when the prince is around, the sky gets red, like it's about to be a fucking storm. And he also has the ability to cause earthquakes, apparently. He also bulges up like a fucking.
Enough about the prince.
Okay, so and like when it's sad, it goes grayscale and gets all gloomy and dark blue, which I really like. And when it's tense, the ocean turns green because the prince pisses in it. He becomes a necrophile in doing so, and he dies.
He kisses her, and then...
No, he fake dies.
It's got incest, it's got pedophilia, it's got necrophilia,
yeah.
It's also got the racism.
It's also got racism.
Yeah.
But and pointless feuding.
So he kisses her, and then the potion's effects transfer over to him as well.
This is a kid's movie, animated by one person. For 4 years straight, he worked on this project. And he also did most of the voices and writing and editing. By the way, I want to note this. This is a cute little thing. The voices for Romeo and Juliet are married in real life. That's cute. That's actually really cute.
It is.
So then Friar Lawrence fake berates everyone for the shit that they've done, even though they've killed tons of people, and that's probably why they had no female seahorses throughout this entire time.
Seahorses.
Sea lions! Whatever.
So
horses,
so then,
lions, same.
Whatever, animals that they encompass.
Then the two families grieve together, and then...
Okay, I sound really stupid, but, like, it's because I have... Alright, I'll just say this right now. It's because I have a disability, and it's kind of hard for me to speak normally. Alright, so I'll just say that now. I won't say what it is. I'll reveal that in a future video. So, yeah, they wake up, and everyone's happy, and they start spinning around in circles like they're in a good times movie. Ever seen a Fearless review? You know what I'm talking about. So then the prince... Oh, but wait, how are we going to deal with the existential threat to the seal kingdom that is the prince?
Pointlessly gendered female.
Of course.
Female! You can't... Yeah, a...
And then he does the same...
Elephant seal. Like,
I'm not a woman elephant seal.
But
she has, like, a chest and, like, eyelashes.
But also, she has the same trunk, which elephant seal...
And also,
elephant seals don't actually
have.
She
also has, like, lipstick.
But then the prince is like, I'm not married.
Except
again.
It works this time.
Yeah. And then they breathe on each other.
It kind of, like, okay, I hate the prince, but this movie is kind of implying that fat, ugly people should just fuck off to their own kind. As if they're not, you know, human or anything.
I think you're reading too much into it, but...
No, I'm not.
Nah, maybe. But...
Well, of course I'm reading into it, actually. It's this movie. So, yeah, we can all put our unicorn masks on and wave at insanity, because this movie sucks! In a great way.
What are you talking about? This was a cinematic masterpiece. This... It was like,
I don't think
fuck The Godfather, fuck Forrest Gump,
fuck Harry Potter.
This is better than all of them. It makes all of those look like shit.
Shit.
It's not so bad that it's good like Thanksgiving was. It's
amazing.
It's different.
Yeah, and also the fact that it was animated by Phil Nibelink alone, that is impressive. That is really impressive.
And then honestly, it looks good.
It does.
For the most part, there's a couple.
Even when there are certain parts where it looks like a Photoshop edit, but, like, it does look really good. The only reason that the quality we have doesn't look good is because I downloaded it on a shitty website. That was the only quality I could get it in. It's really not that common of a movie for you to see around. But, like, yeah. Do we recommend this movie?
Maybe. If you like So Bad It's Good movies.
Yeah.
If you need something to watch.
To be a So Bad It's Good
if you
movie,
want something to laugh at.
I guess if it's the right person, it might be So Bad It's Good. I feel like I could see someone just seeing this as normal bad, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. Whereas Thanksgiving is definitely a So Bad It's Good, no matter
who
you
there
are.
Is, I refuse. There is no way that movie.
Thanksgiving tier of amazing So Bad It, or The Room, obviously, is the...
By the way, we don't need to buy the movie or go on Netflix for that, because I downloaded Dougal because I wanted to savor the memories. So, yeah. See you later, and happy Valentine's Day.
Happy Valentine's Day.
All right.
All right. Stay awesome, everyone.